Alright, this is John Cola with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. This is definitely my last episode here from the Tampa area, because actually literally I go to the hotel tonight, wake up early in the morning, head to the airport, I'm flying back to the West Coast, maybe where I belong, where I like it better, because especially the rain is starting to come, which is good because they need the rain here. But I personally dislike the rain, so I'm glad I'll be going back to my mostly rainless city, which is not good for sustainability, but good for me because I hate the overcast, I love the sun. Anyways, the last episode here in Florida is gonna be worth your while, and it's definitely probably one of the best nurseries I've been to and one of the best organizations or farms growing this very unique specific crop that more of you guys should be growing if you guys are able, you know, in a more subtropical slash tropical environment. This plant will thrive, produce lots of greenery, as you guys will see, that can be turned into a multitude of products. I've visited other Moringa farms before on my travels. Did one there in Southeast Florida. We are here in Southwest Florida, or maybe Central West Florida. I don't know what you guys call it because I'm not from here. But basically, they have kind of like a zone 9AB, maybe more zone 9B, depending on where you are exactly. We're kind of like on the border in the zone 9AB, depending on where the line's drawn. But we're going to be talking about Moringa today. And we are at the Numa Nursery. And this is not just a nursery or a farm. This is a worker and producer-owned cooperative that literally you guys could invest in, right? They're seeking donations. You could put $1,000 and get an official share. And at the end of the year, provided they still stay in business, which I think they will, you'll get like $130 in addition back to your $1,000 at present return rate. In addition, you could become a producer in the cooperative. How would you do that? You could say, hey, I got some land here in the local Tampa area, the local surrounding area, the Lakeland area, and say, put some Moringa trees on my property, right? And they'll basically pay you in cash back or pay you with the different products that they produce here in product for allowing them to grow trees on your property that they take care of, manage, and come around every once in a while and harvest. And actually today, we're gonna get to do a harvest and you're gonna get to see how much literally Moringa leaves can be harvested. And literally, I mean, they're using OPL, other people's land, to basically grow Moringa, and they profit off of that. They share the money back, which is an amazing model. And the other thing I really like about the nursery and the farm here is that they're really giving back to the community. They basically wrote a book on how to duplicate this system in all the different countries around the world. So whether you live in, you know, Uganda, Ethiopia, I mean, I don't care, South America countries, right? They will share with you guys for free, no cost involved, how to start your own worker and producer owned cooperative so you can get this amazing plant out, this amazing nutrition out to people, and create jobs, create a monetary stream, create income for you as well as community, and make the community even better than it is. So man, there's so many things they're doing here. Gonna try to fit it all into one video, and it's gonna be tight. It's gonna be tight. So and it's getting dark. So the first thing I want to start off with was the Moringa, and it all starts with a seed. So Moringa, did the chicken or the egg come first? Well, definitely in the case of the Moringa, did the Moringa tree or did the seed come first? How would the seed be made if there wasn't a tree first? And I don't know how that works, but I'm gonna tell you here how all their trees are planted are from seed. While you can't take cuttings of Moringa and basically plant and root cuttings, right? They do not do that here. That does not produce a good quality plant. If you do a cutting, the root structure is not gonna be that nice tap root that Moringa is known for. It's gonna create a kind of a funky root, although it can root from a cutting or whatever. They don't do that here. They start from seed. So all these seeds that you guys see here, like think if each one of these were a dollar, I'd be like a millionaire right here, all these seeds, look at that. But all these seeds, you know, they have a multitude of uses, right? You know, for me, seeds are the most valuable if they're replanted, because now you could have basically many more Moringa trees, and we need more greenery, especially trees, and especially more tropical style trees that send out tap roots that can live year round, you know, especially to offset some of the crazy, you know, I don't know, carbon, CO2 in the air and all this kind of stuff, right? So plant more perennial trees such as Moringa or fruit trees in, you know, more tropical slash subtropical environments that do not go dormant over the winter. When your tree goes dormant over the winter, it's not gonna be pulling as much carbon out of the air, you know, or CO2 out of the air, you know, than if the plants and trees that like grow year round that actually get good sunlight also year round. Now, aside from growing the trees out of the seeds, right, they do other things with the seeds. You can take the seeds and eat it. So you're eating the seeds, I just killed a tree because you could have planted it. Well, I'm eating the seed. This is good in nutrition. It actually has a nice flavor. I don't know that I'd necessarily recommend eating seeds, but you could do it. They also use the seeds for purification of water, right? You can purify water with it. And also they do something really cool here. They actually press these seeds for oil. To me, I would only press seeds for oil if I have an extra abundance of seeds, which I definitely believe they have here because they, I think, manage well over 1,000 trees in their cooperative that they literally go around and they have a map that I'll show you guys in a little bit of all the different places that in the area where they have actually personally planted, somebody in their nursery or cooperative have planted plants and they basically manage them. So when you have 1,000 trees producing not only leaf material, not only flower material, seed material, not only fiber material that they could turn into, you know, paper or different, like, you know, for making artwork on. I mean, the Moringa tree is so valuable. They have all the leaves and they turn these into many different products. In addition, in this climate, because this climate is optimal for growing Moringa, while I do grow Moringa in the desert, it's not an optimal climate. You know, when it gets over 100 degrees, the photosynthesis slows down a lot. So then the peak of the day, my Moringa tree is just kind of hanging out, getting the sun, but it's not really working. So it's like growing in different parts of the day when it's a little bit cooler. But right now the temperature's optimal in the 80s for Moringa and it just totally loves it. You know, I grow Moringa in a dry, arid climate, but the climate here is nice and humid, nice and more tropical-esque. And the Moringa tree loves it. And the Moringa tree is one of those trees because it grew up in the tropics, right? It is used to tropical diseases, tropical bugs, and it is rarely bothered by pests. So it's a very easy tree or plant to take care of. And this is one way you can use literally other people's land to create your own farm, you know, much like Curtis Stone. I'll put a link down below to the video I did with Curtis where he used OPL, other people's land, to basically do annual crop gardening in Canada where it does snow, right? The Moringa is not a tree that's gonna really work in the snow because it's gonna basically die. And even in zones colder than a 9A outside, it's gonna take a lot of extra work to keep them alive in the winter, so I don't recommend it. But if you live in a zone 9A, maybe like maybe, you know, no zone 9B, or, you know, zone 10 or above, like, you know, and don't freeze, then Moringa is the crop that you guys should definitely be growing without a doubt. Anyways, I want to take you guys on the journey how these seeds get turned into little trees, then they get turned into bigger trees, then get turned into super huge trees that get harvested and then processed into many of the different products that they offer through the nursery. All right, this is their Moringa nursery here, and this is literally, this is like, you know, homemade nursery. What it is, I don't know if you guys can see what this is. This is one of those shelves that you could get at like Home Depot, that those plastic racks, they're like $20. And they're using the racks for the little holes in there so they could put these little pots, these long pots. And definitely trees like Moringa should have actually a long, deep pot instead of those thin, fat pots that are not so deep because they want to send a taproot down, right? Very important to start your Moringa off in a pot that's quite deep. Otherwise, they may not get a nice taproot. And then in the end, you may not get, you know, a good yielding, healthy plant, right? So these seeds were literally planted 2 weeks ago when they acquired their new property that they're just moving into. You know, formerly the owner was actually, you know, renting out space, retail space to basically sell retail storefront, also processing and drying and even sleeping there once in a while. Cause I mean, that's how dedicated he is. He's not getting rich quick or nothing like that, but his heart is into this because he saw the changes that adding Moringa to people's lives could make and getting them on the health bandwagon. He had some chronic health conditions that you guys will learn about when he was younger, and he had to make major dietary changes, and including Moringa in his diet was just one small piece of the pie. The other thing about Moringa that's really cool is these guys grow super fast, right? From that seed you guys just saw into this point right here, right? This only took 2 weeks, right? And this is, you know, in ideal, optimal conditions when the weather and the temperature's right. You know, Moringa will not germinate unless the temperature's right. You know, I use a heat mat inside my, you know, hoop house or greenhouse, you know, to germinate the seeds. And I just basically put the seeds in coconut coir, potting soil, seed starting mixture, and water them. And then they basically pop up. And once they pop up, then I transplant them into bigger size pots, right? But once again, here they try to minimize time, so they basically just put the seeds in the pot, they just basically overhead water, and they've gotten actually a fairly high germination rate. I see a few seeds that didn't take, but I'm going to estimate like 95% plus, and they get into this. Now once they get into this size, then there's lots of things you could do, right? You could harvest these guys already. Most people would not harvest these for eating, because you wouldn't want to do that, because that, once again, sacrifices the tree. Like when you eat A seed, you're sacrificing what could grow, and when you eat these guys, you're sacrificing what could grow. But that being said, I've never tried baby moringa, so baby moringa, I'm gonna eat you right now. Maybe he'll come back. Wow, oh my God. Baby moringa, it's like moringa microgreens. There's a whole new use for the seeds. You can grow moringa microgreens, Ran. This is like the most tender, delicious moringa that I've never eaten before until today. Although I will say, I'm now getting that mouth burn feel. Even stronger than the seed, right? Moringa has a kind of a hot, spicy flavor, and that's probably the isothiocyanates, which are anti-cancer properties in the moringa that I'm getting, and actually it's in there to prevent the bugs from eating it, right? See, every plant makes all these different plant compounds, whether you want to call them, you know, phytonutrients or phytochemicals, secondary plant metabolites, I don't really care what you call them, but the plant doesn't make that for us. It makes it for the plant so that the bugs and disease and all the different insects here in Florida are not eating these plants. Look at how healthy these plants are. I mean, I want to hold this up for you guys because you guys can't see. Look at that. All these plants, I'm like, there's a few that are looking a little bit funky, but for the most part, they're all green and just doing really well after just 2 weeks of growing. Next, I want to take you over to another area of the nursery where they actually have 2-month-old plants. All right, so what you guys are seeing right next to me, they have in, I think, 3-gallon pots, like 2-month-old plants. So from the 2-week-olds, you know, pretty soon they'll be planting these guys up. They maybe put a bamboo skewer on there to act as a little stake to kind of help keep it erect instead of growing kind of funky. They also have this in a good, fairly good sun area with like little shade. And these guys start growing. I mean, literally these guys are off to the races. They're about 1 foot tall. Once again, you do not want to eat them in this stage. You want to let the tree get a lot larger before harvesting, you know. And the nursery here, they like to sell the plants when they're in this stage to you guys so that you are off to the races and going to have a healthy plant. You know, selling something in a small little starter, you know, although they do ship those, I don't necessarily recommend buying those because, you know, the more established a plant is, the more resilient it is, and that means the harder it is going to be to kill, especially if you've never grown anything before. Luckily, moringa will just literally grow in the wild, and you know, you do need to take care of it a little bit, but it will do good even if it is a little bit neglected, like in this climate zone. Once established, you will not even have to water because it does rain every so infrequently, provided you have a good soil with a good organic matter that's gonna hold some of the water, because literally here in Florida, you guys are pretty much growing in sand. And so let's see, after about 2 months, it looks like this. Now I want to show you guys, actually, even after 6 months, they start harvesting this plant to use in some of the products they make. All right, so in this line behind me, basically, these are 6-month-old plants that they've already harvested, right? So once again, I want to remind you guys, this is a 2-month-old plant. You know, it hasn't really created any wood yet. It's really, you know, thin, going to fly around the wind. You know, once it gets to the 6-month mark, what happens is you can see it almost starts to make some kind of like little bark thing here. And then what they did was they basically just cut it back right there in the middle. They cut the leader off, and then now it's shut off 2 new growth tips, right? So here's the thing, man. If you let the moringa grow like this, it'll get tall, man. It could get like 50 feet tall, right? So you don't want it to get that tall because then it's too hard to harvest. You know, I've read online that, you know, in the areas that they grow moringa, basically they'll just cut it, and then basically it'll just shoot out new growth. So every year, not by me cutting it, but due to this cold weather that I get, it dies back to the ground, so I basically just, I help it along and cut it back and then mulch heavy so I'm able to keep the root zone alive, and then it sprouts up on its own every spring. They do that on purpose here so that they could actually harvest the leaf material and also encourage to grow a nice bushy plant instead of a nice tall tree. This makes the harvesting much easier instead of having to climb up 20 feet into the canopy and harvest everything. They try to keep it as low as possible, right? And so this is one that's been trimmed, and you can see this is already pushing three new growth points instead of one. So it's going to have now 3 times the leaves just because you basically topped it. So, I mean, that is really the key to growing moringa is to cut them regularly, right? Cut them after the growing season, which is about now, October, when it's grown all summer long. It's going to get into the cold season here, and cutting it back will make sure that you get a good harvest. Also encourage the tree to go a little bit dormant over the season, and then start off in the springtime when it starts to warm up with a good growth spurt. All right, so now I wanna show you guys the difference a pot, or in this case, a garbage can make, right? So once again, here's a 6-month-old in a small 3-gallon, and this is one of the nicer ones they chop back, and then it's basically spurted back with regrowth. And I want to remind you guys that, you know, in the 6 months, this is 6 months over the summer months, not 6 months over the colder months that we are getting this growth. Obviously, in the summer months, we have warmer days, longer days, so there's more sunlight, which means faster growth for the Moringa, as well as many other crops. So I'd never look forward to getting into the winter when our daylight goes down and the temperatures get colder and the microbes are not working as fast, and neither is the whole photosynthesis process. But anyways, this guy's grown in 6 months, and same thing, right? In a garbage can full of good potting soil. Look at this guy, man. This guy's also 6 months of growth that they basically topped off, and now they got all this new upgrowth, but this is like a much fatter trunk. So if you were to take one of these plants instead of keeping it in the pot, to plant it in the ground, then they could even have bigger growth and even grow faster, you know, in actually the real world environment when they're actually connected to the earth. You know, there's something to say about grounding technology for us, walking barefoot in the soil, sleeping with a grounding cord or a grounding blanket, which I do because I'm that hippie. But we really want to get the trees connected to the ground because, you know, in the ground, they're grounded. And, you know, according to some tests that I've seen and I want to run them myself, plants grow better in the ground than in a pot insulated, you know, from being in the actual earth, feeling that earth, getting that electrical charge from the earth and being grounded that it should. I think the next step is I want to show you guys some nice huge trees because, you know, as much as this, they just got into this property 2 weeks ago. So from side growing here on the property that they just inhabited 2 weeks ago, literally, they have planted over the last 5 years thousands of Moringa trees over 300 different properties here in the Tampa Bay, St. Pete area. So I don't know if you guys can see that map here, but this is a little map of the area. And every dot is actually where they have, they're using other people's land to grow the Moringa that they then harvest, give back to the owners of the land with product and or Moringa leaves that the owners could come out any day and harvest. And also they teach the owners how to use the Moringa in omelets, to make smoothies, to juice, to do all these different things so that they could access the benefits of this amazing crop. Now, the reason why you guys want to grow Moringa is because it's one of the most healthiest foods you could eat on the entire planet, according to research. So they have this little chart here. I don't know if you guys can see that there. But basically, Moringa oleifera for balanced nutrition, 25 times more iron than spinach, 15 times more potassium than bananas, 10 times more vitamin A than carrots, 7 times more vitamin C than oranges, 2 times more protein than yogurts, 17 times more calcium than milk. Hey, make Moringa smoothies instead of drink milk. It's also a lot easier on the planet, and I think Moringa is a lot easier to grow than a cow and to milk it. 4 times more fiber than oats, right? They always say, yeah, eat oats for your fiber. Moringa has even more fiber, right? And Moringa is a crop that's easily grown. I mean, yeah, try to grow oats in this climate. I don't even know if it's possible. But anyways, so they basically have over 3,000 different trees planted in over 300 different locations. And what I want to do next for you guys, because pretty much here at this site, they just have a nursery because they're setting up their permaculture food forest. Literally, as I speak, they've got all the plans and the plants, and they got a whole system of like setting up where things are going to go, and they're getting that going. I want to take you to one of their locations where actually they're growing the trees and have been for some time, and maybe we'll even be harvesting some of them today. All right, so where we're at now, we're here actually in the country, just maybe 5 minutes from the home base of the cooperative, and this is basically one of the places, the land that they harvest Moringa off of, that they manage the trees of. So this has an orchard with different kind of fruit trees for the owners, but the owners planted these Moringas about 5 years ago. And from about after 2 years, the co-op started basically harvesting and managing and taking care of the trees and basically giving back money and products to the owner here. So he does not have to deal with the Moringa trees and chopping them or, you know, pruning them to keep them nice and compact and keeping them healthy. So you guys can see like there's a number of Moringa trees. They're basically, I think, planted, I would estimate maybe 12 to 15 feet apart, with a fruit tree in the middle of them, whether it's a citrus or avocado, many different trees in this system. And they're basically just, number one, they're planted on mounds, very important. And number two, they're using lots of good mulch around, as well as growing things like sweet potato down below for ground cover. Anyways, these trees were actually harvested about just 1 month ago. So I'm gonna show you guys actually what the tree looked like 1 month ago. And then I'm going to show you guys actually what it looks like today. So this is how nice and compact a tree looks once it's been harvested. And on these 40 trees here, when they did harvest a month ago, They yielded about 50 kilos of dried product that then they sell for $100 a kilo. So do the math, that's a lot of money. Now, before that, this plot was not harvested for 6 months. So literally in 6 months of growth, they needed 50 dried kilos of product. 50 times 100 is like, if they sell it at maximum retail value, if you got buy in bulk, you get discounts, of course. That's like $5,000 in 6 months off land that is not even theirs. And they have over, once again, 300 different locations. Now, not every location has 40 trees, Moringa trees like this, but they may have one or two trees. I mean, you could have, just a house in the middle of Tampa or in St. Pete, and you have a couple trees that then they'll come around and manage and harvest so that you could use your land to grow more food for the local people without you having even to lift a finger and you having access to the Moringa trees all year long, depending on the time. So, you know, in this climate zone, in this area, once again, it's like the Lakeland area, you know, they do not harvest these trees between December and June. That's when it gets a little bit too cold up in this area. But if you're living down in St. Pete, you could actually harvest year round. So they go down to St. Pete and keeps them busy because it's, you know, a frost-free zone for the most part, you know, down by the water. You know, so it's kind of a more tropical location that the Moringa tree really survives in. As I said a little bit earlier, they're kind of like right on the border, on the cusp of where Moringa will do good or it won't do good. Like if you go more north, more inland, right, Moringa is not going to be as productive as it is here. You're going to have a lot more challenges. So this is a tree, when they left 6 months ago, this is what it looked like. Now I'm going to show you guys literally within 1 month what the tree looks like today. All right, first I want to correct my numbers here. The $100 a kilo is actually the wholesale price if you buy a kilo, which is actually a lot to use. Most people don't buy a kilo. So he basically breaks that down into little 5 gram bags, 10 gram, maybe does he have dime bags too? Anyways, those sell for a lot more money. So literally he's making a lot more per kilo if he's selling in smaller quantities. That being said, I would like to sell things in about a 1 pound quantities to make it affordable for people and make it easy for them to consume. So what I want you guys to do right now is compare, you know. This is literally 1 month ago when they left. All the trees look like this. And then literally in 1 month of growth, it looks like that. Like, look, that's a lot of growth literally in 1 month. 30 days of growth right there. And now I'm going to go ahead and show you guys how much that yielded. We're going to go ahead and fill up my rental truck with all the leaves that they will now just harvested. All right, so now I want to show you guys actually how they harvest the Moringa. This is not rocket science. So they have this little saw here. This little saw, this Irwin, I don't know where they got it, but they probably harvested over 1 million pounds over the last 5 years of Moringa. That's fresh, not dried product, with this little saw. So, you know, they'll basically come up to a branch and basically saw it down because when they normally harvest, it's nice, thick, old wood. And they'll basically just saw it down and drop it to the ground. Then they'll collect everything they drop to the ground and then take it, throw it in the van. In this case, they're throwing it in my truck. But you know, when this stuff is young, basically you just come down and you basically just snap this off. I mean, this is how easy. I didn't even use a knife, any kind of tools. I just came and snapped these branches off, right? And I'm actually doing the tree a favor now, because now what's happening is I'm removing all the ends and the tips where the hormones are produced. And now the tree is saying, I'm in crisis mode. I'm getting eaten by something. A human is harvesting me. You know, I need to basically shoot out more growth tips and grow more branches. And that's how the tree works. This way they also keep it nice and short. I mean, I think they prune this down to, depending, most parts of this is like no higher than 6 feet, maybe 10 feet tall, so that all the new growth is always pretty low. So you can basically just grab it and break it off. And then you can, be processing it into the different various foods. Now, one of the things is I would encourage you guys not to harvest too young. Normally they do not harvest at a month old because the month old greens have not been connected to the plant for longer. The longer the leaves are connected to the plant, the more nutrients literally those leaves are going to suck up. So they're harvesting at a more mature age to get more nutrients in the leaves at that point. Now the nutrient content of the leaves will vary depending on the life cycle, whether it's, you know, young baby like I ate earlier in the episode, whether it's more mature or whether it's more mid-age. And probably honestly the best is to harvest it at all different ages to get the influx of all the different nutrients when they are at different ages, because the age does make a difference. All right, so what you guys are looking at now is the back of my rental pickup truck that they upgraded me to, so that was nice. And they basically all that stuff from 1 month of growth right into the back of the truck, including the stuff I just chopped down in that last scene. throw it in the back of the truck. We're gonna go ahead and drive this back, show you guys how it get processed. Plus, I think some other guys have come back with even a larger tree that was maybe like 50 feet that had been growing maybe 6 months. So we're gonna get to see how much that tree yielded as well. So this small tree, literally 1 month, and all this, it might look like a lot in the back of a Toyota Tacoma pickup truck. That's not sponsored. but all this will get processed and dried into literally maybe 1 kilo, maybe 1.5 kilos, but at least 1 kilo of dried product from all this fresh product. I mean, it really condenses down when you remove that moisture, but that means if you're eating the 1 pound or the 1 kilo of food, you're literally getting this much fresh, because when you take the water out, it concentrates all the different nutrients. Now, that being said, as much as the dried product is concentrated and it's definitely good for you, I would encourage you guys also to eat the fresh product. The only way you're gonna have fresh product, fresh Moringa, is if you grow it yourself, or if you're lucky enough to live in the Tampa, St. Pete area, Lakeland area, all this whole area that they serve, right? They will plant Moringa for you on your property. You could have the fresh product for the most times of the year, and then you could also get some dried product from them. So, I mean, that's just a good deal for me. Plus, you'll also be able to use your land to feed the community in their growers co-op and producers co-op. All right, so we just got back to the nursery, and actually I got a load of Moringa that we're gonna go ahead and unload, and they're gonna get processing. So we're gonna show you guys how this fresh leaf turns into the dried packaged leaf that they sell, that they could then ship basically anywhere in the country, sell at local farmers markets, give back to the landowners that is allowing them to grow the Moringa. But also the big Numa nursery van just got back also with another harvest of a 50-foot tree. So I'm gonna show you guys that next. All right, so we just got back from harvesting that Moringa tree, and they got the Numa nursery truck here, which is actually all hand-painted. Like, to me, this looks like it was wrapped, but it's all hand-painted. And actually at farmer's markets, you see them ask for a little coloring thing, and the kids could color in the different scales. That's kind of cool. Anyways, we're gonna go ahead and open this up and show you guys actually the big harvest of Moringa. Let's see, it's totally stuck. Look at this. This thing is packed in. This is like a, I don't know, 50-foot tree that basically just got topped out, and there's like no greenery left. We literally left the stump in there, but I mean, the stump is still goes up into the air like, I don't know, at least 15 feet. You can still see branches have to climb in there. But this is a lot of yield. I mean, this is how over one season, literally, this was not harvested since last year. Over one season, they got all this, basically all these branches, all these sticks, all the leaf material, they could turn the fiber, all this will be used in some way, right? Be composted, turn it into like fiber crop. All these leaves are gonna basically get washed, processed, dried into basically leaves that they'll sell for, I think, like, I don't know, $100 a kilo locally, or if you wanna buy a couple kilos online, price goes down. They could turn it into different kind of teas, they make soaps, all this kind of stuff. Look, and I'm still pulling it out. I mean, this is crazy. And this is only one tree. They have more trees than one tree at this one location, right? Look at this. We got some, I see some flowers in there that they can basically dry and sell flowers. I mean, this is a long van. I mean, I could be here like for 5 days unloading this by myself. So I think I'm gonna get some help, and we're gonna come back at you when I got this, all this Moringa pulled out, and we got a huge pile here to show you guys the enormity of how much you could harvest off one established tree in one season. Ah! So now you guys can see the enormity of basically the Moringa that was harvested. Literally, this was harvested before the summer. It's grown the summer and now harvested again. And this is an established 5-year-old tree that was planted when the co-op here was started. I mean, this is how much yield they could get. Yeah, there's a lot of stick yield, but basically they were doing the, you know, the lady of favor whose tree it was, because now they just removed all this material. And this could get turned into different products, fiber products used for artwork, or even in some cases they will actually replant these guys, you know, and they may even grow a good taproot, although definitely preferential to start from seed. But if you just quick and dirty free way of starting a Moringa is just to take a stick like this, dip it in the ground, put it in a hole, may root on you and grow a new tree pretty quick style. So I want to show you guys this. Here's a leaf, and these guys start to dehydrate and get kind of limp really soon. So it's very important once you harvest it is to basically take it inside and process. So, you know, that's what the guys are gonna start doing. They're gonna start processing this and laying out to dry, which I will show you guys in a minute. But before I do, I want to show you guys the flowers. So these are Moringa flowers. These are quite rare. You don't see these too much, you know, and I just always like to just harvest the flowers and just eat them raw. They could be used as edible flowers. They have a nice, more mellow flavor. tad bit sweet, but also you get that moringa strongness. I don't know how to describe the strong moringa flavor. Tastes a little bit like kale, like the leaves do, but different. You know, it's a little bit strong flavor. It's kind of hot and spicy, but not really hot and spicy. The cool thing I like about them here is that if there's flowers they find, they'll basically separate out the flowers and then dry them separately and then just sell little packs of flowers. Every different part of the plant has a different use, which is what I like that they use, right? The flowers also have amino acids in there, right? This is what the bees collect, you know, in the pollen. So now when you're eating the flowers, you're getting the bee pollen, or actually just the pollen from the tree, which is what bee pollen is directly, which is high in protein. And so, yeah, I think I'll eat some more flowers before I take you to the next level and how they will be processing these leaves next. All right, so now I want to show you guys actually how they wash and dry their greens properly. It's not rocket science to basically process moringa. I do this my at home myself, and I actually have a very similar process. So first they take out the large branches here that they have in a pile, and they basically strip off each one of the off the main branch. They strip off the singular stems easily and quickly, just like this, right? And then you're left with, you know, just a little twig there that then they will compost. They then take the leaves here, and then they dunk this in a solution of basically aluminum-free baking soda and water to clean these out. Brush that back and forth, and then maybe shake it off just a little bit, right? Once they got this leaf clean, then they're gonna go ahead and take the leaf and they're gonna strip this down. So they wanna strip off this main stem here, all the material. So they can come down, and just like this, they basically now have all the leaf material and the smaller stems, and then once again, this is composted or you know, discarded, right? Once again, we're taking a stem, just come straight down, boom! You know, drop it on the drying tray. Once again, strip the leaf off, drop in the drying tray, big stems go out, the small stems, the secondary stems, you know, are totally fine. Once again, take it and strip it off really easily. Let's pull that one all the way through on the tray. I think we got a few more of these guys to do. Super simple, super easy. It goes fast once you do it. Actually, I just was processing moringa, you know, before I left my property. And anyways, they basically have locally harvested bamboo that's grown locally. They basically harvest. They screw together with like some kind of decking screws. And they basically have the like a mesh netting material that then they basically will fill up these trays. And then they'll basically bring it into their drying room. So let me go ahead and show you guys the drying room next. All right, so now I'm gonna show you guys actually how they dry the moringas. You guys saw me basically starting to prepare one of these drying trays here. That's basically the bamboo, locally grown with the net material. And they basically fill these guys up, put these in a special room here, and turn on the fan. And then they turn on the dehumidifier right there. And the fan and the dehumidifier is all they need. They don't need to pump in like hot air into here. They just basically need to pull the moisture out of the air. And that's what the dehumidifier does. You just gotta make sure you empty it every once in a while. It'll basically make the moringa leaves sweat, and it'll pull the moisture out of the air, so that literally it'll you know, pull the moisture out of the moringa slowly and gently, right? I do not encourage you guys, although many places like, oh, sun-dried moringa or sun-dried fruits, I encourage you guys not to sun-dry things in the full sun. The sun UV rays can break down nutrition in the foods, although it will dry faster. That's not necessarily the best way, in my opinion. I mean, the best way would be freeze drying, but on the scale that they're doing here, the home freeze dryers that they make, that would do the leaves properly, you know, would not be able to dry the volume of moringa they have. Yeah, so then and some people do shade drying. Shade drying, I mean, drying could be, if you don't have a dehumidifiers and fans, could be as easy as basically washing the leaves and hanging the leaves up in bunches, you know, underneath rafters, you know, in a shed that's literally getting nice airflow. Actually, I visited a place that's actually drying moringa in this fashion. I think they're in like in the Dallas, Texas area. I forget the video, but I made a video on it and showed how they're drying the moringa to make moringa powders, just like, you know, just simple and easy without any kind of extra, you know, fans or dehumidifiers or even drying racks, by just simply tying them up. So there's really many ways to, you know, make that happen. And in their drying process here, you know, they'll basically fill up this room with racks and racks, which they have made out of more bamboo, locally harvested, and some wood, just to kind of like get it, you know, get a nice airflow underneath them. It'll take them 3 to 4 days to dry the harvest, you know, to the proper dryness level, so then they could then take it and then process it into some of the products, which I'm gonna show you guys next. So you guys just saw the process of how they take literally the fresh leaves from me harvesting the leaves to washing them, stripping them, drying them into their flagship product. What is a flagship product? The flagship product is right here in a Ziploc bag. This is green leaf material, dried green leaf material now that then is crushed up and can be sold. This is an excellent source of protein, you know, and super nutritious, as I stated earlier. So, I mean, this is like 250 grams that they sell. In addition, they also can turn that into a powder. So they put this into a Vitamix and then basically grind it up even smaller and then sift it out. I did recommend they start using a vacuum blender. So they, in a Vitamix under vacuum, so they'll preserve more nutrition. And then they basically make their green powder that then can be added to smoothies, added to many different recipes and used. In addition, they basically can take the same leaf material here and put that in a different bag and call it loose leaf tea, right? They could also take this and put it in little tea bags, sell a little 10 packs of tea bags if they wanted to staple the tea bags up, and sell tea bags if they want to, right? They've had, this place, this cooperative, has more products than I've ever seen in Moringa in my life, and that's really what it is gonna take. Some of these are really easy to make. You know, here's another product. You could sell the dried drumsticks. You could sell fresh drumsticks. You could sell fresh leaf. They actually ship up fresh leaf from Florida here to New York to different Indians that wanna buy it in bulk and use it in different stews, chutneys, and sauces and whatnot, right? They'll actually basically seep out the Moringa leaf. So they basically take Moringa leaves and they'll basically soak it in 190 proof alcohol, organic alcohol. They'll soak it for 1 year, right? So now they'll get an extract of the Moringa and basically make a Moringa leaf extract that then they will basically put in little professional style bottles and sell these guys, which is basically you're buying mostly alcohol with some Moringa in there. And you know, that even concentrates some of the nutrition in Moringa. In addition, they basically will take the leaf powder that they've made in the Vitamix and then encapsulate them, put them in little capsules in case you want to basically, you know, ingest these in a simple and easy way. I do encourage you guys to get the leaf powder and just, I mean, I'll spoon it in my mouth whole raw, but some people don't like the taste of these things, so at least you can get them in you if you swallow those in capsules. Oh my gosh, and then here's the Moringa flowers. They basically sell, harvest the flowers separately, dry the flowers separately, and we'll sell you guys dried Moringa flowers if you guys want them. Those are how basically, here's some of just more of the Moringa tablets, as well as a Moringa spice that they're using some of the Moringa with other spices, you know, mixed in there. So it has mostly Moringa powder with cayenne and turmeric and other powders. You know, their goal is to actually grow many of the different ingredients such as the turmeric and ginger that's in this spice powder here on the new permaculture food forest that's going in. In addition, they basically have air-dried Moringa loose leaf here for smoothies, teas, and toppings that you can just sprinkle on salads in a small format in case somebody doesn't know what Moringa is. They can just buy it and try it in a little format. And this is how they really make their money, right? If you buy it in a large bag, you're gonna get it for cheaper. But if they break it up in a little small packet, then it starts costing a lot more. So I would encourage you guys, you know, to buy it in larger volumes to save more money. In addition, oh yeah, here, check this out. Here's their Moringa tea that they actually put in little tea bags, right? I mean, basically it's the same leaf product in different forms. Grind it more, make the powder, you know, encapsulate it, sell it as, you know, in tea bags, charge people more money for it in the tea bag because now you have to do more processing. They will basically sell the Moringa seeds in little seed packages that you could, you know, use to plant out or grow. Here's more seeds. If you want more seeds, you could also purify water with these seeds. They have Moringa with mint. So now just they get some, you know, dried mint. They could grow it themselves, or if they, you know, buy it from like Mountain Rose Herbs, mix it with their Moringa. Now they have mint Moringa leaf tea instead of just straight Moringa leaf tea. Value added product. I mean, really the money in this business is value added product. Don't just go to a farmer's market and try to sell leaves. They expire very fast. You're not gonna be too successful. But once you make a tea, Who's not going to want to try Moringa plus mint tea? You already drink mint tea. Most people might drink mint tea. Now have Moringa too to get the additional benefits from seeping the Moringa in the water. And if you just want to try a little bit of the leaf powder, here's some of that microfine leaf powder they grind up in the Vitamix and then sieve out to have the little powder there in little packages. And you know, here's a stand-up basically leaf powder. Now to me, this leaf powder looks really good. This has been basically air-dried, not in the sun, and it's keeping a lot of nice vibrancy, you know, unlike many of the Moringa products, right? I always encourage you guys to buy Moringa products from a local U.S. grown source, right? A lot of Moringa products come from maybe Africa, from India, maybe from China, who knows where they're coming from, who knows how they're growing, how they're processing, how they're drying, and even if you are getting 100% Moringa product, right? Some of the powders, you know, once they're powdered up into this form, unless you do like mass spectrometry on it, you're not really gonna know what's in there. There could be contaminant, there could be bugs and pest parts in there. They could be basically, you know, adding stevia or other green, cheap, inexpensive green powders as a filler and calling it 100% Moringa when it really ain't. You know, because the farm here pretty much only grows Moringa as the leafy green, and that's what you're gonna get in all these. I mean, this is legit stuff here, guys. In addition, they make Moringa deodorant there, right? Also, they sell like little things of Moringa oil here, I think. They have a deodorant and cleansers. They have bath balms they make. They basically will press out the seeds to make oil, which I'll show you guys in a second, and use it in the Moringa soaps, which actually have a nice scent. Here's an activated charcoal Moringa soap. The bath bombs, if you got a special someone, hey, get a Moringa bath bomb, make your own. They also sell actually other related products, so they can easily grow lupins here. They collect the lupins and sell you lupin seeds. I mean, they've really created a whole product offering around Moringa and also other easy to grow plants in the area. I think I basically covered everything on the table. Well, I didn't even cover this here. This is really cool, right? I mean, this is really what attracted me to the company. When they did this, I'm like, man, that was a lot of work to put in that. I could tell that they're really, their heart is really into the Moringa. They actually have a Moringa starter kit. And look at this box. Number one, it has that same design, you know, that is actually hand-painted or, you know, hand-done. It's on the van. But all inside the box, which is basically just decorated on the box, and the outside is kind of all artistic. Moringa around the world, and it's basically just the different names. It's called the Miracle Tree, Moloko, Shivga. I mean, I don't know. All these different names, I don't really know. But inside this box, check this box out. I did show you guys the box earlier. Inside the box, there's like printing end to end. I mean, this is an efficient use of the cardboard, right? Look at that. Numa Nursery, it explains the whole Moringa story. It's basically like newspaper article size, and all in the whole box is basically printed. There's not 1 inch of this box that is really wasted. It isn't printed even down on the bottom on the fold. It's printed, talks about like figure A, B, C, how to start the seeds up. And inside the box, you basically have a starter kit of all the different products so you can sample them, get to know them. They got the deodorant and cleanser here. They got the Moringa oleifera air dried loose leaf for smoothies, teas, and toppings. They got you a little like tea ball, so like it's reusable, so you can basically fill up your loose leaf in the tea ball to make your tea. You got some seeds that you can plant in your garden. They got the Moringa leaf extract right here. Oh, they got this guy. Oh, this is the Moringa seed oil. I'm gonna show you guys how they make this in a minute. Actually, they're sold out of oil. That's why you know, they didn't have a lot on the table here. They got the Moringa, actually these are the tea bags, the pre-filled tea bags. They got the Moringa powder here. They got the Moringa tablets here. And they got the Moringa spice. So somebody comes to their farmer's market booth and says, I don't know what to buy. They say, buy the sampler kit so you can find out which of the Moringa products you really like the most. Plus learn about Moringa and even grow it yourself. So I really like that they put together this Moringa starter kit, literally. I think the next thing I want to do in this episode is actually show with you guys how they actually press out the Moringa seed and make oil. All right, now I want to show with you guys actually how they make the Moringa seed oil. Once again, you know, they do all the processing of the Moringa on site. The Moringa seed oil is made with basically this this press, right? Stainless steel single auger press that presses out the Moringa seeds. This press does have a heating function, which may be needed when trying to extract oils from certain crops, fortunately, Moringa is not one of them, so this is basically a true cold press other than the heat that is generated during the pressing process, right? So they have a nice funnel system to basically feed Moringa into the machine that I'm not going to show you guys, but they're willing to share the design of that. It basically just uses a 5-gallon like water bucket thing and stilts. So I'm just going to hand feed. So we'll turn this on, and now we're going to take these fresh harvested seeds that's been dried, probably very important to use wet seed to do this, and we're basically just going to drop it in to the unit, right? This unit, what's inside, what's happening, there's a little single auger, kind of looks like an old-fashioned meat grinder, if you guys are familiar with that. It's basically just grinding up the seeds little by little, and crushing them down, and literally pressing and squeezing out the oil. So nothing's coming out yet, might take a little bit, and you don't want to put your fingers into the hopper. As you guys can see, we're getting basically the Moringa seed cake out of the end here. This seed cake, a little bit warm, not super hot yet. That's what it looks like. And now literally this the seed cake is dry. It's like juicing your vegetables, which I do encourage you guys to do, to juice your vegetables actually. I encourage you guys actually to juice your fresh Moringa leaves. I have a video where I actually am juicing fresh Moringa leaves. Put a link down below to that video. That's one of the best ways you could consume Moringa is by juicing the leaves. I actually made a recipe with pineapple, celery, and Moringa leaves, which were quite excellent, right? And this is like definitely a slow process, right? We're putting the seeds in there, and then basically it's coming out. And look at this seed cake. Now the seed cake is coming out warm, so I don't know that I'd say, although this is cold pressed, there is some heat generated, from the pressing process. And you can see some of this seed cake actually is kind of oily. So if I just take this and kind of rub it into my skin, we'll see some of the oil that's actually coming out from the seed. It's not quite started to come out of the bottom yet, so we're not collecting any oil, even though the seed cake's coming out a little bit oily. So let's see, we're gonna continue to do this until we get some oil. Sometimes what needs to happen is the temperature of the auger press needs to heat up before the oil is extracted. This is how the seed cake is coming out now. These little oil extractors are really cool. I've extracted my own flaxseed oil at home. All right, so I finally started making Moringa seed oil. This is definitely takes a lot of seeds, right? You don't just put 5 seeds and make oil. Basically what has to happen is you have to put a lot of seeds in. You gotta keep it feeding, because if you stop feeding, then the oil is gonna end up in the pulp like it was earlier. In addition, they put a little of they put a little pad underneath the machine, to basically, instead of having it straight, to have it raised up a little bit. I probably would extend the feet so that they automatically will make the machine sit up. And once it starts coming with the oil, you can't stop feeding the Moringa in, right? And the Moringa, I mean, these are not maybe considered a super oil seed, although they do have oil within them. I'm sure something like coconut would make a lot of oil, you know, better, easier, and faster, as our flax, because I think these is less oil content. So they're really, in my opinion, burning through lots of Moringa seeds to get a little bit of oil. So this is, and once again, this is done the right way. There are other methods to make oil, using hexane extraction, using chemicals, but they're really doing it the old-fashioned way. Literally what's gonna happen is they could process all these seeds, run this machine literally 12 hours to make, you know, a glass full of oil, and they gotta keep the seeds running through the whole time. They'll watch videos and watch movies while this is literally running. I mean, that's a testament to this machine here that literally can run for 12 hours straight to press out their oil. I got a pretty good flow on it now. I just keep dunking it in, and we got a drop here, a drop there, and this will basically all add up. To me, this is just simply too much work, but literally, Kendrick here, the guy that started the co-op, he's a fanatic about Moringa. He really wants this information to get out. He's super passionate about the Moringa. He even wrote a book that he shares for free, and a training online to let people know how to start their own co-op just like this. I mean, just after doing this for like 10, 15 minutes, I'm getting tired of creating the oil already. So, I mean, he sits here for hours feeding this in to make sure that he could turn his Moringa seeds into a product that people can easily use, because most people are not going to just simply use the seeds alone. I think I've had enough. We're going to go ahead and turn this off here, and we're going to see how much oil I did get. So all that pressing, and I've been here a little bit, made this much oil. Now this oil here, wow, it is cool to the touch, actually, so I would consider this raw. You could eat the oil. They use it in cooking. First time I've ever had fresh extracted moringa oil. It really has a nice flavor to it. You could actually take this and use it for beauty care, rub it into your face. It's a thicker oil. They do strain this normally. It is a little bit, you know, we did get some particulate in there. You could use it for beauty, for facial oil. Wow, really nice flavor, although it has that kind of like bitterness of the moringa leaf or the seed that I ate earlier. The other thing, if you're getting a moringa oil that's highly purified, that's clear, that has no flavor, then you gotta kind of really wonder how is it made and is it really moringa oil? I can verify and vouch that the moringa oil they make here is the true legitimate stuff, and it takes a lot of seeds to make the oil, and they go through a lot to make it. Anyways, the last part of this episode, what I wanna do is actually wanna sit down with Kendrick, the owner and founder of this co-op here, and talk to him more so you can learn more from him about moringa. He's lived on farms in third world countries for lengths of time on a moringa farm to kind of learn how it's grown and get inspired about it, and is literally on a mission to change the food system, change how farms and nurseries work to make people be able to have more farms and nurseries in their local area, and literally duplicate the system and all the products that he makes here. He's sharing this knowledge with you guys like open source style. I really love making videos like this when people are just like, yeah, I'll share all my secrets with you guys. Because here's the thing, people that are really in the know, like me, like Kendrick, like some of the other people I've had on in the past, Josh from Boogie Brew comes to mind, right? We just want the knowledge out there. It's so important us to have the knowledge out there. We're creating competition, you know, that's great, but we don't look at it as competition. You know, if you're really smart, you're gonna think, you know, somebody doing this down the street is not competition. They're gonna be getting more moringa trees growing, more trees are gonna pull carbon, CO2 out of the atmosphere, more people eating moringa, right? To basically make the pie bigger instead of taking a bigger piece of the pie. The pie is so small right now, there needs to be significantly more education about moringa. Everybody that goes into the grocery store and buys some hamburgers or hot dogs to eat, right? They have no idea what moringa is. Everybody in the world should know about moringa and its properties, its benefits, how it can be used, and how even it's you know, a better protein source, in my opinion, with more nutrients and phytonutrients, than meat and other animal foods that people are eating, right? So that is really what's happening, the education component. You could be at a table at your local farmer's market, you know, to educate people about moringa so that more people could get on literally the moringa bandwagon. So now I have the pleasure of introducing you guys to Kendrick Henry of Numa Nursery, who basically makes this moringa happen here in the Tampa area, has planted literally thousands of trees himself in over 300 different locations around town, drives around in his van, manages them, harvests them, processes them, has started that cooperative, the co-op, the producer and worker-owned co-op, that now he's trying to spread this information far and wide. He has a master's degree, actually in architecture. He went to school for 10 years, and literally to make this business happen, he's been living literally at his girlfriend's house that at one point broke up with him because she didn't want to go out with him because he didn't have a bed. He didn't have a bed that she could sleep in because he'd always go over there. He'd sleep in his shop. He even wrote like this free book here. And this is an ebook you could download and print out. And this is a full book and manual and training he does on how you guys in any country where you live, as long as you could read English and hopefully it gets translated into other languages at some point, you could start your own growers cooperative, producers cooperative near you to, you know, create a revenue generator for you, your community, and get this amazing plant, moringa, that is so easy to grow out anywhere in some of the tropics and subtropical areas of the world. I mean, this can literally be the solution to hunger, to poverty. This little tree does it all. So I have lots of questions for him today. We have limited time left on the SD card, and we have some of his products here that I've already gone over. So let's just get right into this. How did you even get into moringa and get inspired to be like the moringa as the sole product instead of, you know, growing some kind of fruit trees or sugarcane or any of the other major crops you could grow here in the Tampa area?
I was sick, and I was looking for something to help heal my liver, heal my colon. I had onset Crohn's disease from the time I was 13 years old to 25. And when I first tried moringa, essentially I knew that something was happening inside my body, and I fasted off of Moringa alone for 30 days.
So how did you do that? Just like Moringa juice, Moringa leaf powder and water, or what did you do?
Yeah, all of that. I would just eat the leaves fresh. I would just eat Moringa in a tea form and also in a powder form with water. And essentially 30 days, just Moringa and water alone. And it pretty much got rid of all of my symptoms of everything. And I've been pretty much healthy as all ever since then.
Wow, so I know, you know, a bigger part of the story is besides just doing a Moringa fast, you also made some dietary changes also to get rid of the processed food, yeah, the junk food, and even went towards a plant-based diet. Is that correct?
Since then, 7 years ago, from that moment that I fasted, I've been plant-based ever since, and I use Moringa mostly in my diet and every meal that I prepare.
Right, yeah, I mean, once again, I encourage you guys to eat a wide variety of plant foods. Moringa is one of the many foods I like to eat for its benefits. Kendrick likes to get the Moringa out to people because it can be that initial spark that basically makes your engine fire. It can be that spark that gets you to start feeling better. And then the person that he gets the Moringa out to is like, what else can I do to get even healthier? Moringa's good, but you shouldn't just have Moringa and then continue to eat the McDonald's, because the Moringa is not going to solve all your McDonald's problems. Getting rid of the McDonald's is going to solve your McDonald's problems, in my personal opinion. All right? And junk food problems and processed food problems. Another thing I really like about Kendrick and what he's doing is actually he's farming on OPP, other people's property. That doesn't stand for the OPP like the song back in the 80s. but the OPP, so literally you're making tons of money.
That's right.
You know, that get reinvested. To basically grow Moringa on other people's property. And this is even better than the Curtis Stone model, in my opinion, because, you know, on Curtis Stone's model, you have to, like, get one person to, like, give you, you know, a little space, and then you're farming that on a constant and regular basis, taking care and managing, you know, annual crops that may not be improving the soil as much, that does not improve the soil as much as a perennial tree does and perennial crops. So, like, literally, today, you guys saw, we harvested a one-month-old tree that hadn't been harvested in a month. We didn't get a lot of yield off that. Normally, he'll wait, like, 6 months, 3 months, depending on the time of year. The winters, you know, there's a longer elapsed period before harvest, and then in the summer, things grow faster, so you could harvest literally after 3 months. And the van you saw was, I think, harvest after 3 months, literally, like, that whole van's full of leaf, you know, material that's going to get turned into powder. But, like, this has been a big revenue generator, so you want to share with people, like, of all 300 locations and 3,000 or more trees, like, how much revenue can you generate from all those trees, you know, based on, like, the harvest that people saw in the video today?
Essentially, I started because I didn't have any land of my own, and I wanted to plant these trees, and I wanted to support myself. I didn't want to necessarily go work in an office as an architect. I wanted to build a business and create a name for myself, but I wanted to use nature. So what I did was I started planting Moringa trees on other people's property. Just knocked on door to door to door to door and said, hey, can I plant a tree in your yard? They're like, sure, for what? And I said, because it's the Moringa tree and you can eat it. And so now people are grabbing from the trees, they're eating it themselves, they're preparing it. And the most important aspect of this is actually educating each person that grows the tree. They call me and say, what do I do? When do I harvest? How do I use it? When do I do this? And you know, and then they call me and say, hey, our tree is huge. Can you come by and harvest it for us and cut it back for us and make it look pretty? Because they grow big and fast and get real spindly and have lots of sticks. And it's not necessarily as aesthetically pleasing as a lot of other trees, but it's so nutritious. And so that's why we use it and we grow it, essentially.
Wow, so like off, say, one tree in a right location in the tropics, like one of the ones down in St. Pete off one tree, how much economic value does that have to you as a business now when you go harvest it?
Good
like
question.
for the whole year, one tree, whole year.
All right. So starting from year one, that first tree, we might cut it back several times, and every time you cut, it splits. And we might only get maybe a handful that first year. But by that second year, we may be able to harvest an entire kilogram of dried powder, from that 1 year old tree.
And that's $100 worth of basically powder.
Now, there's a lot of work that goes into it. That $100 gets broken down into labor costs and energy costs and things like that. But essentially, you can get a kilo off of one tree within 1 year of growing it from seed in the ground. As long as you cut it back early, people don't like to cut it. They'll let it grow real tall and spindly. It looks like the truffalo tree from Dr. Seuss. We cut it back so that way it splits low.
Yeah, they do it, cut it back like I showed you earlier. Even after like 6 months, they cut it back so it starts to split early. And then let it grow a little bit more, cut it back again,
and
keep splitting.
And then it's bushing out. Yeah. And so from that one tree, we'll get at least a kilo, and we'll dry that out within a year. And then within 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, by the fifth year, we're getting a kilo every 2 months from that harvesting tree, from that same tree. So we're not just getting 1 kilo a year. We're able to get 4 or 5 kilos off that same tree.
Wow. And then you guys could do the math. He has like over 3,000 trees, 300 locations. And let's talk about, you know, some of the products. So like, say the green powders, which is what I like the most because they're easy to incorporate. What do you sell a kilo of green powder for?
You know, at the farmer's market, we'll do $100. But on the website, we have specials right now. If you buy more than one, you can do like five for $300. So you can get 5 kilos for $300.
Of the powder, or the leaf powder?
The leaf powder, yeah, this powder.
Oh, the leaf powder, oh, versus like the whole leaf, the tea stuff.
Leaf?
Yeah, the loose leaf.
We'll do a whole kilo of the loose leaf for $50, half that price.
So the processing and the sifting.
Because right now our process is in a Vitamix, and it takes a lot of labor to sift it out and get a really nice fine powder. So that process has to, you know, raise the cost.
So this is the $100 a kilo, literally.
Yeah.
That you're
and
getting.
This right here is about 100 grams, and we sell this for $20.
I see. Yeah. So I mean, as you guys can see, this could be very financially viable. Now let's compare, you know, your Moringa leaf powder here from something at the health food store. Like, how much does a pound maybe of Moringa leaf at the powder from the health food store cost, number one?
It's about the same price.
Ours
is a little bit more expensive, you know, but at the same time, the quality is...
Yeah, so now next, let's talk about the quality.
Okay.
So how does your quality differ than a Moringa leaf powder, you know, from India or Africa? Not to say that those are bad, but, you know, when they're doing it on a big commercial scale, there's middlemen, importers, exports that have their little fingers in the pot taking money out, and things may not be as high quality. If you could find somebody importing it directly and they're supporting like women-owned farmers and in some African company, country, and they're doing it right, absolutely support them fully. But just be aware that the quality can vary widely.
Widely. And I have experimented. I've opened up bags in the store, smelled it. I can smell there's other things in it than Moringa. The color is not good. It's brown. It looks dead. I don't feel the energy coming from it. It's not vibrating in my hands. We even Brix meter it right there in the store. Dead. You put ours, boom, alive. And everybody will tell us that purchases from us, uses our Moringa. It's essentially the most highest vibrating Moringa that they've ever tried in their life.
I don't know. Have you tried mine?
I'm gonna go to your place next.
Yeah, you go to my place. I basically grow my Moringa, I harvest it, and then I freeze dry it, and then I powder it under vacuum.
Yes.
That's the next level. But you know, I definitely will say, of all the different operations I've visited so far, I really like that. I like your operation because you're decentralized. You're growing in many different places, so you're having many different soil types.
That's right.
You also then get to dry many different stages and ages of leaves. And also, you're dehydrating or drying the leaves in a very good fashion, in my opinion. You're not like running blast heaters on it and drying it in 2 hours or something like that at high temperatures. You're not drying this in the sun where nutrients are going to oxidize, the product might turn more brown. You actually have a fairly nice green powder, you know, not quite as vibrant as when I freeze dry it, but it's some of the highest quality Moringa that I've actually personally seen. I really advocate your drying method with just a fan and the dehumidifier. There's no heating involved, which will, you know, ensure there's more enzyme activity and probably more nutrients in there as well. So let's see. So another thing, a part of what you're doing, Kendrick, is you're doing a lot of education. So you want to talk about, you know, for those of you guys that are out there that are farmers in other countries or even in the USA, they're trying to generate some kind of economic revenue and maybe a more tropical area, maybe Houston would be prime target, you know, some of the lower states, you know, like near the Gulf where it doesn't freeze, like this model can be duplicated. And literally, you've written a book here on how to duplicate what he is doing, right? He's not trying to like patent this and like not share. No, I'm not sharing. You can't make $1,000 a year from growing Moringa, right? He's sharing with you guys everything, the whole process, step by step.
How to sell it.
how to sell it, how to grow it, how to make it, you know, how to knock on doors and ask people to use their property to grow it, so that as long as you got some chutzpah, you guys know what that is, chutzpah, you can make it happen. Moringa is not a hard tree to grow if you get, you know, regular rain and you're not living in some kind of drought conditions, right? It's a very tolerant tree that's used to literally living in the wild. So you want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. One of the biggest problems that I faced at the farmer's market over the last couple years was people not knowing what Moringa was. That was the single most factor when people would come to the booth excited about what this product is, and they think they know what it is, and I say it's Moringa, and they have no idea, have never heard of it. It's not in the store.
Why? They know what a Big Mac is, but they don't know Moringa is.
They what? Do the Moringa? What is that? Okay, so like, yeah, we're going to say, hey, this is Moringa. What is it? It's a tropical tree that we grow right here in the neighborhood, and we're bringing it to your door right here. And now we have some of the most dedicated customers and friends that have never heard of Moringa before us, that they're now spreading out to their friends and family and letting people know, hey, this guy Kendrick, he's growing it right here in the neighborhood. You don't have to get it from India. You don't have to get it from Africa. You can get it right here in your own backyard. Matter of fact, we can grow it in your own backyard.
Yeah, you want to talk about that?
Okay, so one of our biggest marketing strategies actually in this whole thing is pay for your property taxes by growing Moringa trees in your own backyard. Generate thousands of dollars off of Moringa from having us harvest it and sell it for you. Your own trees and our products, and it's going out there to the door next week. It's going out to people and they're using it and it's helping them. It's getting rid of several problems and conditions that people have.
Sure, from what you've heard from testimonials. So,
yeah.
So I mean, literally, if somebody planted one or two or 40 Moringa trees like we showed you today, what would be the revenue that somebody, the owner of the property, would get back from the co-op?
Well, it varies from first year to fifth year, you know, depending on how many times we're harvesting, how many trees you plant. But right now, it could be $100, it could be $1,000. And right now, that 40 tree plot, they're generating several thousand dollars in revenue a year from our trees.
From the trees
from
that
their
we just,
trees.
From the trees that they are growing, you give them several thousand dollars back a year?
Yes, right.
A year.
Pay for his property taxes.
Wow. Imagine this model if you could duplicate this in other places, right?
And he didn't have to touch it. He didn't have to put a hand. We came there and we got paid too, because off of the several thousand dollars that we were able to give back to him, we also made profit off of it as well.
So does he have to like water or do anything else to it, or like spray it with chemicals or fertilize it or anything?
No. I mean, he waters it, he has a well, he turns it on, it's automatic, but there's no chemicals or anything in there.
So then also like other people in the area, I mean, do they water the trees, or will it just rain enough here, provided there's no kind of drought, that
yes,
there's just enough water that the tree will just survive and thrive on its own?
That's right. It's a drought-tolerant tree. And so in the wintertime here, it's dry season. And we do tell people, if they want to increase the yield, go ahead and water it. But no reclaimed water. Try to do rain-harvested water. At most, we try to tell people, you know, use a rain cube, you know, use an IBC tote, or use a 55-gallon drum, and water your Moringa trees with that. So we're trying to help set people up with rainwater harvest as well.
Cool, and you pay based on poundage or per tree, or how does that work?
Yeah, every time we go harvest, we bring it to the shop and we dry it, and then we calculate how much they've provided for us, and then we break it down from there, and they get a market price value of, at the time, they get the returns on at the end of the year in the dividend form.
Wow. So then the homeowner would really want to try to make sure that he maybe waters a little bit when
That's
it's
right.
a little bit of drought, to make sure his yields are higher, because that means he's going to get paid more at the end.
That's right. And he's taking care of them, or she's taking care of them.
Right.
And she's watching them, and they're loving on them, and they're caring for them, and they're also eating from it every single day. That's the thing. They're putting it in their foods every day. They can go right to their backyard and grab it for themselves. So when I show up, they're like, I got everything I need. Give it to the community. What else do I need? They say, take it, Kendrick. You can have it all.
Yeah, because he basically will prune down the tree so it looks nice and pretty, and then comes back with a nice tree-looking plant instead of some nice, tall, spindly Dr. Seuss-looking thing.
I cut the tree today, and she literally came out and said, Kendrick, it's beautiful. I love the way it's majestic. The sticks. I'm like, oh my gosh, I love it. Some of the owners are really great. Some of the owners are just learning about cutting it back. They feel like it's hurting the tree, but we tell them, like you mentioned earlier, it's as if there's a storm outside and nature is rustling it up. These soft woods, they break in nature on regular, and then from there they regrow, and that's how they evolved, and we're just assisting in that process.
Right. Yeah, so I actually really want to talk about the training course that you designed for people literally around the world, in the country, wherever you guys live. So why did you really create this, and why are you sharing literally all your trade secrets on exactly how you did this, so that other people in other countries, even people here in the U.S., even people down the street living from you in Tampa may want to duplicate this and start their own Moringa Growers Co-op. Like, why would you do that?
The reason why I made the Moringa Tree Professional Training Course manual is because every time people would come to the farmer's market, they didn't know what Moringa was. And I wanted them to have a classroom where they could learn from start to finish, from seed to tree to harvest to product, and how they could start their own Moringa business. Essentially, we want other people to be able to create a lifestyle of their own, work for themselves, and provide healthy Moringa products from local sources. That was our main goal in creating the manual, so that we could educate people. Not only that, but around the world, there's a lot of people that don't know about Moringa, even in their own backyard. We get calls from Africa, Mexico, India, and we're wondering why they're calling us and asking us how to teach them about growing Moringa, when they're growing Moringa in Africa, and they tell us because they're not growing Moringa the right way, and they're growing it commercially, and they're using pesticides and herbicides, even though they're advertised as organic. And so that's why it's important to always know your farmer, you know where the sources are coming from, because supposedly in other places, and even sometimes here, it's not always what you see is what you get. And so that's why I wanted to be transparent with the co-op, and give people the most information that they can go off and literally feel confident that they can eat the Moringa tree that's in their own backyard and know that they're getting the right and proper nutrients to essentially heal themselves. And that's what our main goal is, because we want people that are feeling tired, depressed, sick in any way to feel this high vibrational food, superfood that you can put in your own body from your own backyard.
Cool. So another thing I want to talk to you about, Kendrick, is all the different products you make, which is totally amazing. I mean, usually people see like grow the Moringa, they dry it in a leaf, maybe they sell like loose leaf tea and they make some powder, but you have like, what, 30 different products that you make out of Moringa. Now, why did you come up with 30 different products, and how did you come up with all of them?
Well, the reason why I came up with so many products is because diversity. We wanted to be able to have a feel, someone that was... When I only had one product on the table, which was the loose leaf, someone said that they wanted powder. Okay, so I wrote that down. The next person said they wanted capsules. I said, okay, I wrote that down. And so people would be coming into the booth saying, I want Moringa this, I want Moringa that. And I would take their notes. Hey, can you make Moringa this? Can you make Moringa that? Bug spray, spice, the Moringa seed oil. It all developed from what the people wanted. They were asking me, hey, can you make this? Can you make that? And I said, let me find out. I came home and I started experimenting myself, and I have literally developed all these products by hand over the last 5 years from the Moringa trees that I've harvested. And everybody is loving all the quality, high quality that we're coming out with. We literally sit the Moringa greens in organic grapeseed alcohol for over a year.
The fresh greens or the dry greens?
Fresh greens inside this bottle for over a year. So that way the alcohol is literally pulling out all the trace minerals, all the vitamins, all the protein, and it's put it in a liquid, soluble form that bypasses the digestive system, goes straight into the bloodstream within 8 seconds. People are getting rid of migraines and headaches. They're dropping their blood sugars and blood pressures within just a few seconds, and it's saving people's lives. I mean, we have so many
tests. By the tincture.
By the extract alone, yeah. It's unbelievable. I mean, we could go through each product, and I have testimonials of how people have said that it's gotten them off of certain medications, and it's gotten them pretty much back to normal. Stasis, balance. It's all about balance.
Wow, and I think that really the key there is, he listens to his customers and makes changes accordingly.
That's right.
You know, some businesses don't listen to their customers and keep their customers happy, and then they get reviews as such. So, you know, that's a really important aspect of your business. So I really value you for, you know, doing that and making products based on what they want. Because guess what? If they want it, they're going to buy it. And I'm sure, you know, there's probably more people than that one person that asked. Now you sell thousands. You probably should give the guy that asked you for the capsules, give him a free bottle, man, because now you sold so many capsules because of that one guy who said, I want capsules.
Yep.
How do you come up with the whole oil concept? You know, I mean, when I was making oil, in my opinion, it burns through lots of seeds to make not a lot of oil. And what are the uses of the oil? Because that's something I rarely ever see. you really got to have an abundance of seeds, in my opinion, to make the oil. So talk about that real quick, Kendrick.
Well, I started looking into cosmetic products. My girlfriend, she loves putting things in her hair, on her face, skin, nails, for burns, cuts, bruises, and I started looking into the properties of the actual Moringa seed oil, and I found that it had tons of antibiotics, tons of antioxidants, it was anti-inflammatory. So I was wondering, hey, can I put this one product, the seed oil, to make any other products? Sure enough, the seed oil itself can make hundreds of products in its own. So we started developing soaps, bath bombs, and we're putting our Moringa seed oil in our bug sprays, and we're just making, like, little by little, we're starting to incorporate Moringa seed oil in every little thing that we have. It can be an ingredient in any little thing, or it can be set alone in itself, in its own right, as a healing oil. You can use it in aromatherapy, you can use it as massage, you can rub it in certain trouble areas topically. You can also ingest it, and it's helping people get rid of eye issues, ear issues, infections. It helps regrow hair. People that are suffering from hair loss, they can use it on their head or on their body. And everything that you put on your skin is in your bloodstream within 8 seconds. And so just know that you're rubbing that oil in there, and it's getting in there, and it's helping to relieve any kind of stress or pain that you have. You can rub it on your temples. I do it all the time. And I use it on my face at night, and I love it. The hair, people say, oh my gosh, you have such thick hair. And I said, it's because I consume Moringa all the time.
Wow, that's amazing. Yeah, there's so many products that can be made, and then even derivatives of the oil products, you know, like the soaps and, you know, the bug sprays and everything. I mean, it takes a lot of processing to make a little bit of oil, but when you have literally thousands of trees that you're harvesting from, you know, you have extra seeds to turn into products. Now the question is it in your manual how to make all the different products? So if somebody wants to, like, make their own oil, do you tell them exactly what press that you're using? Do you tell them the exact process to make the extracts and even the tea bags here?
Where
with the
we
mint?
Get the tea bags, how we made this box, like,
yeah, I mean, it's like a pro box.
Yeah,
man.
I designed it myself.
Totally cool.
I use Photoshop. Literally, I made all these little logos by hand myself.
Can you tell them where to get it printed and everything?
I have got this printed from Cypress Folding Cartons, a local company right down the street from here. He totally hooked it up. I walked in. I said, hey, I'm just starting my business out. He literally was like, here, let me help you make these boxes. And ever since then, he's helped us make the starter kits and pretty much labels, unbelievable. Local companies. I go with all local companies, label companies, bottle companies, glass companies. Tampa is a mecca for business and industry. So we have everything right here in the neighborhood that I could ever want, and all local.
Wow, amazing. So literally, I mean, this is like, you know, you guys want to have a franchise. You got to pay money to buy the franchise, and you got to pay royalties back to the franchise. You know, this is a free, once again, free download. Learn how to grow Moringa, sell it, process it, everything you guys need to know. This is amazing. So Kendrick, thank you for putting this all together. How does somebody download your training manual and even get a hold of you for questions? And is there a charge for this?
No. You go to my website. My phone number is on the website. You can call me. You can text me anytime.
Wow, you might get a lot of calls after this video, man.
That'd be great. I would be very thankful for that. And that would really help launch our business and get to the next level, because we definitely need it. And we're helping lots of people with your help. Thank you so much for just coming out here.
Oh, man, it's been my pleasure. I had a fun time today. So, Kendrick, are there any questions that I should have asked you that I didn't, or anything that I maybe should have showed in the video that I maybe left out? What would that be?
Oh, man, I think you covered everything. I've just been enjoying this whole trip, you know, just being here. We just moved here last week. Met you at the farmer's market on Sunday at Hyde Park. You're literally here right now, and I just can't believe it. And literally, I was like, should I have him come out? We're just getting set up. No, come. Just get here. There's no better time than now.
Exactly.
Don't waste any more time to post videos and think that you need a post-production editor or anything like that, sound. Just do it as fast as you can. Get your information out there, what you have to say, and I love you for doing that. So thank you.
No worries, man. I mean, if you're at a farmer's market, I will find you.
Yeah,
I have special skills.
And I'll be there too, selling Moringa.
Yeah, so I mean, if you have a real farm and I'm visiting a real farmer and you're at a farmer's market selling product and I'm in your area, I mean, guys, that's where I find many of the different farms. I mean, I know some from in advance and I plan in advance, but sometimes I just show up at farmer's markets because, number one, I'm eating local food when I travel to different places. And number two, I'm scoping out farmers. I mean, I've seen so many farmers at the Tampa Farmers Market that are really cool. And I went to like maybe two of the guys, and I had some other farmers already pre-arranged. But I always usually have some open time in my schedule to try to fit somebody in to come to show. I mean, and how important this video is. I mean, this is probably one of my most important videos of this whole trip, because I mean, this is training manual that literally you are sharing your trade secrets with other people around the country, and more importantly around the world, and you're giving yourself access for free to the like the Moringa Man knowledge base right here. You put your phone number online, you're gonna get nailed with calls after this. But you encourage it because information is free. That's so important to me also. That's why all my videos are free. I'll never have like the small video for a little bit of, for free, and then the extended version, you gotta join my club or whatever. I'll never have one of those clubs. Information is free. I wanna make differences in the world just like this guy is here. You know, he's an architect, went to school for 10 years. You could probably be in a desk job, architect job, designing all kinds of cool stuff. He does his own permaculture designs that he's like gonna be installing here on the site, so I can't wait to come back to see how it's evolved and future years, he'd be probably making tons of money, but he's not. He's hucking away, living in his girlfriend's bed, you know, drying moringa,
not anymore.
You know, making the powders, getting these out to people, and more important, getting the information out to you guys. Oh my God, this is like a KQED or public television thing. So, man, do you take donations? And somebody just really felt heartfelt with, man, Kendrick's doing a good job. I want to help him to continue so that he could, you know, he's trying to buy this place. He's renting it now. He's gonna hopefully buy it if you can come up with the funds and
rent to own.
You know, rent to own.
2.5 acres right here.
How can somebody really support you, man? What can they do? Can they buy your products? They can't buy your training book. It's free.
The first thing you can do, download the manual. It's free. Learn about Moringa. Grow Moringa. Order seeds from us.
Yes.
Start using Moringa in your everyday diet so you know it for itself, what it's doing. Then at that point, you will be a believer and you will know that you need to be growing Moringa trees. Every place and space can be utilized to grow food, and that's what we're trying to do here. If you'd like, please support the co-op, numanursery.com. Order some of our products. Give me a call if you need anything, any help. If you want us to go plant some trees on your property, give me a ring. I'll be there. We'll start planting trees right now.
So this is cool. So like all everything we talked about Moringa is Moringa in this zone, particularly definitely related to zone 9A, 9B, depending on where you are in zone 9A. My zone 9A, definitely the Moringa loses its life in the winter. So let's talk about that real quick before we go. I know you don't have a lot of experience with this, but I know you have a lot of experience growing Moringa. So for example, for people that live in New York City or North Dakota or, you know, Chicago where it snows, or Colorado, can they grow Moringa as an annual? Because I don't want them to think, I can't grow a Moringa because I don't live in the tropics.
Like, no.
Tell them what to do.
We ship Moringa trees all over the country.
So they sell Moringa trees too if you want to get some good genetics.
Those little cone pots that you showed earlier, you can literally order those on our website. We'll ship them 10 in a box. They go out every day. We're shipping Moringa trees out from those cones. They're going to New York. They're going to Canada. They're going to Northern California. They're going to Wisconsin, Wyoming. They're going to Michigan. And every single time I tell people, just bring it inside as long as it has a fan and it's got a sunlight, a grow light, and you're able to put some wind on it, open the door every once in a while, keep it a little bit humid in there, have a little grow room. You can pull it back out in the summertime and grow it all year round. You can harvest it in the summer. It'll go dormant in the wintertime. It might just be sticks at the time. Harvest it, cut it back, let it just be a stick in the wintertime in a pot, and then you can bring it back outside in the summertime. And so, yeah, just keep it, you know, above 40, 50 degrees at that point. Once it drops below that, bring it in, cut it back, let the sticks just stay dormant, keep watering it, keep loving it over the wintertime, and then bring it back out in the spring, and you'll have a fresh green.
Yeah, just don't overwater, especially when the tree's in the dormant season, because it could cause root rot, actually has happened to me because all my stuff's on an automatic watering system, and I ended up overwatering my Moringa, so I'd rather maybe do it a little bit more manually. And what size
pot? Stick your finger in there, if it's moist, just wait. It's a drought-tolerant tree. Yep. These trees love it high and dry. And so if you're overwatering, you're right, it's gonna yellow out, it's gonna get mold, it's gonna get fungus. But if you just keep it nice and dry with some sunlight, as far as like maybe in a sunroom or even like an actual light, a grow light inside with a fan on it to keep the bugs from being able to form around the sticks and stick to any part of the bark, then you're good to go. And we have testimonials of people growing Moringa trees in New York City inside their apartment for years.
And let's talk about like what size pot do you recommend?
Okay, so it just depends on how big you want, but right now we're recommending at least a 5-gallon pot. right now, which is about the ones that you saw outside.
The deep 5 gallon pots, not the wide ones.
And so you can even use a 5 gallon that you could get at a store.
Oh, like a bucket.
A bucket. You can use a bucket. Put some holes in the bottom. Get a nice dark color bucket. Even a white one is fine, but usually the darker the better. That way the roots feel like they're underground, and they feel really just not as exposed from the light. And so just get a nice dark 5 gallon bucket. Deeper the better, because then you can form a nice tap root, and that'll help the tree come back. It stores a lot of energy in that tap root. And that young tap root, believe it or not, if you have several trees and you want to harvest that tap root, you can eat it and slice it up and put that on your sandwich.
Is it like a horseradish?
Radish. Yeah, it's a horseradish. Yeah, that's why they call it the horseradish tree.
Right. Yeah, sure. Wow. Amazing. Wow, this has been one action-packed, knowledge-filled episode here with Kendrick. So, Kendrick, if somebody wants to get a hold of you, any kind of social media or things you want to share, what would that be?
That'd be great. We're on Instagram, Numa_nursery. You can also visit numanursery.com. We're on every social media outlet. You can find us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Numa Nursery. Also, I have a personal page that I'm building, my architecture brand, Kendrick Henry Studios.
All right, cool. I'll put links all down below in the description to be sure to check those out. And also be sure to share, number one, share this video with other people that may be interested in Moringa, maybe looking for some kind of economic opportunity. If you have friends in other countries that are tropical countries, I mean, this is the video they should definitely watch to see how easy the process is, how they could start generating some financial revenue by using OPP, other people's property, to make, you know, extraordinary amounts of income. And, you know, and help their local community to build it even better by connecting people, by talking to people, because we are so closed in these days. We don't even know our neighbors. If you could start going door to door asking your neighbors if you could plant Moringa trees, they might think you're crazy. Oh, that's that crazy hippie guy.
Yeah.
You know, but that's all right, you know. It's education is the key. That's why I'm so passionate. I've stayed here until 8 or 9 o'clock tonight making this video for you guys. I got to go to the hotel, eat dinner. I haven't even eaten dinner yet. And then go to bed, wake up, and catch my flight back to Las Vegas tomorrow. Be sure to share this video. Also, if you guys like this video, hey, thumbs up this video. That'll encourage me to come back next time I'm in town. I really want to see his permaculture food forest he's putting in. He's going to have a full-on nursery here, growing different kinds of Moringa in the ground, because there's more than one type of Moringa, which I didn't even get into today. He's going to have different varieties of Moringa planted so you guys can see the differences here in his permaculture garden. So it'll be like a living museum and example of what could be done on a 2.5 acre property if he is able to buy it. And that's going to come up coming next year. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below, so if I do come back, you don't miss out on that episode. But I do have other episodes coming out every 3 to 4 or every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up. I'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, dedicated to teach you guys all about how to start your own farming business, visiting farms, growing at my home in my backyard, or showing videos on how I grew in my front yard, and visiting compost tea places, visiting compost places, visiting worm casting places. I show it to you guys all, like, unfiltered, you know, 100% content. They do get long, but they're also very important, so that literally my videos, in my opinion, can change your life. I meet people all the time. John, thanks to you, I've saved my life. Thanks to you, I'm growing my food. Thanks to you, this thing. And it's, oh my God, that's like the most joy you could ever give me. Not any kind of money. John, how can I support you? Can I give you money? Like, I really don't want your money. Share my videos more. Spread the knowledge that I've shared with you. Spread that with others. We need to make changes from the grassroots. That's how things are going to happen. You talking to your neighbor, you talking to your friends, getting this out to more people so we get more people on board eating a healthy, natural diet. Because when you do, let me tell you guys have like a brain shift. Things change. You don't value the almighty dollar as God, and you don't screw countries. You don't screw your friends for money. You want to give your stuff away for free because you want to make a difference in the world. And you will be, you know, an instigator for change. So, you know, thank you, Kendrick, for doing all this. I appreciate it so much. I think I got to get going here. But anyways, I think that's pretty much it for this episode. Once again, this is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing and grow some Moringa if you live in the tropics.